is a small part of the Indian Heaven volcanic field near Mount Adams. It's in the Gifford Pinchot National Forest in Washington. This is a pretty remote spot. It's difficult to get to and it's far away from traffic and people. These old lava fields with lots of recesses and miniature caves and even bigger caves make great habitat for wildlife. I observed a pika up the hill a ways, and there is evidence of bushy-tailed wood rats in some of the more recessed areas. Fresh water flows nearby. That makes this place an ideal habitat for predators. I'll bet that after nightfall, you find owls, bear, bobcat, even mountain lions roaming these hills. Wouldn't it be amazing to capture photos of some of these animals? My name is Michael Durham and I've been a photographer for over 25 years. In that time I've found that camera traps, or trail cameras, can be a wonderful tool for getting photographs of interesting and elusive animals. From creatures very large to very small to even the very fast, camera traps have the ability to capture amazing wildlife images. You can get started with an off-the-shelf camera like this. They're easy to find at Amazon or Cabela's. But what I'm talking about is a custom system using a DSLR setup like this. You have a lot more control over the light, the exposure, and the composition with this, and the images are a lot better quality. However, these are a lot more complicated to set up and a lot more expensive, but the results are worth it. This lava tube cave is not very deep, but it has clear evidence of animals living in it. Bushy-tailed wood rats, which is a native wood rat, clearly live in this cave. That means predators may come down, may try to hunt in the cave. I'm going to put a camera trap inside with a motion sensor pointed at the entrance. This has the potential to be incredibly interesting, and it also has the potential to be absolutely nothing. That's part of the gamble when you do a camera trap. For a good custom DSLR camera setup, you basically need three things. You need a camera, you need a sensor or something to trigger the camera, and you need light, typically a flash unit. Let's start with the camera. This is the camera I'm going to use for this setup. It's an older Canon Rebel. It's a T2i with an 18 megapixel sensor. I'm agnostic when it comes to camera brands. I've used both Nikon and Canon. If I were to say what the absolute best trap camera would be right now in the middle of 2016, it would be a Nikon D600 or a Nikon D800. These are industry leading low light performing cameras with full frame sensors. They're really good cameras. But they're also very expensive, even used, and if you've ever lost cameras from being stolen or having them destroyed, cost can be an important consideration, especially if you're deploying more than one. So what I've taken to doing is typically I use a used Canon Rebel. For instance, this 12 megapixel Canon XSI and this 18 megapixel Canon T2i, I've picked these up used from $150 to $300. The Canons have other features that I really like. For instance, the remote live view and tethering features are very handy when using remote cameras. This is an inexpensive Nikon D3200. It's got a high resolution 24 megapixel sensor, one of the highest resolution sensors I use. These cheaper Nikons unfortunately do not have remote live view, and it has a weird proprietary Nikon USB port, and also kind of a strange remote port as well. This is a Canon 5D Mark II. It's another camera in my rotation of trap cameras. It's a good, high-resolution, low-light camera. It's bigger, it's bulkier. It'll set you back more than a Canon Rebel will, but the batteries on these cameras will last forever, especially if you use the battery grip. One of the other advantages of the Canon is you can adapt it to a lot of different lenses. For instance, Nikon lenses, especially the older ones with an aperture ring, work great for camera traps, and the adapters are fairly cheap. You can also use inexpensive screw mount M42 Pentax lenses. These are really good lenses. They're actually fairly sharp and they're also fairly affordable. I found them for as little as $20. This all works because you don't want to use autofocus for camera traps. Manual is best, so any good manual lens will do the trick. I also do use native Canon lenses, and wide angle lenses are especially good. This is a 10-22, one of my favorite camera trap lenses. No matter what the camera system, I hack the cables running off the camera to have the exact same remote ports. In this case, this Canon has a 3.5 millimeter stereo cord connection, and so did this Nikon. This cable runs to the sensor, so I can swap out sensors and cameras, and they all work the same. People have come up with 100 different solutions for protecting their cameras from the elements. This is my simple solution. It uses a cheap food container, which is a bonus. Some people use pelican cases, other people use very expensive waterproof housings. For me, this works as long as the camera stays upright and it's locked in place. It generally is well protected. It's a very basic setup. This is a piece of ABS plastic that protects the lens from rain. There's a waterproof bag that goes over the hard shell of the plastic. And you can see the actual food container. This actually does a good job of protecting the camera from impact and also keeps the sensitive components within dry. This camera is now all buttoned up in its weatherproof housing. It's completely enclosed. I have a small USB cable that comes off the side, and with that I can hook it up directly to the computer without getting into the housing. This is invaluable for locking in focus, checking my exposure, checking my composition. This is the motion sensor I'm going to use for this cave setup. It's a passive infrared and it should do a good job of watching the cave entrance. There's a lot of choices when it comes to motion sensors. It's extremely important to have a reliable sensor that will trigger the camera when you have an animal in the scene, but isn't so easily fooled by wind or blowing leaves. There aren't any perfect solutions, but there's some pretty good options. There are two basic types of sensors, and a third one that just recently came on the market that has some interesting capabilities. The first type of sensor is an active infrared sensor. This uses an invisible beam of light and an eye that watches the beam. If that beam of light gets broken, bam, the camera gets triggered and you have a photograph. I like beam sensors because you can be fairly precise about your trigger points, which makes it easier to know where the animal will be when you take a photograph. The very first sensor I ever used was this invisible beam intrusion sensor from a Radio Shack home alarm system. It's got a reflector, and you line up the reflector with the beam, and anything that passes between that will get its photograph taken. Now, these are not made anymore, but they are easy to find on eBay. Typically, they're not very expensive, maybe $20. They're pretty easy to convert to use with a Canon camera. The bad news is that they require a lot of power. If you want to deploy them for a couple weeks, it'll take a 12-volt battery, something like a car battery. Probably the very best active infrared system that uses a beam is made by TrailMaster at trailmaster.com. This is called the TM1550, and this is a really well-made unit. This is the transmitter, this is the receiver. If you buy one of these, make sure you get the second generation unit. What's nice about these is they're programmable with camera controls and timers. So you can actually set a clock to tell it when to take photographs, when not to take photographs. You can program it to take photographs of larger animals like bear or elk and avoid smaller ones, or you can adjust the sensitivity so you definitely get smaller animals. The second type of sensor is a passive infrared. This is the most popular sensor used by camera traps today, probably because they're the easiest to set up. Basically, you just point it at a section of the landscape and anything that moves through it is pretty much going to get its photograph taken. It keys in on heat and movement, but the sensitivity is influenced by ambient temperature and humidity, so it can be a little less precise. This is an example of a passive infrared sensor that I built from a kit that's available at snapshotsniper.com. You can see how small it is, and it'll run for several years on a single little battery. Because it's a kit, it requires building, and it also requires pickaxe programming. And if this is something you're not familiar with or don't want to mess with, there's a second option available from Jeff Dale at trlcam.com. Jeff makes great equipment, and the sensor he makes is rock solid. It's a little more expensive at around $200. One of the potential problems with this sensor type is it actually has such a wide perspective. It can detect animals before they come into the camera's view. I actually add a feature, a PVC tube. This lets me narrow the perspective of the sensor and lets me have a fairly precise point that the camera will be observing for a trigger point. For $300, TrailMaster makes its own version of a passive infrared sensor. You can see it's a fair bit bigger. It runs on 4C batteries and will last about a year with those. It's got camera controls designed into it, and it's very robustly made. You can see that I also outfitted this one with the same PVC pipe that I put on my other units to restrict the field of view. The third sensor is something new that I want to share with you. I haven't had a chance to actually deploy it, but it seems like it has lots of interesting promise. This actually uses LiDAR, which is an invisible laser, and it's made by Cognisys, and it's called the Saber. Now, probably this is the most versatile of any of the sensors that I'm going to show you today. It has the precision of active infrared and the ease of use of passive infrared. It also has its own Wi-Fi system, and then you can use a smartphone app or even a computer to control the parameters And it's really well thought out software that lets you do a lot of different things, and it has a million different camera controls. This is a really well made unit. It's got an internal battery. I don't know how long that lasts yet. Probably I'll use a 12 volt supplemental battery when I deploy it. But again, this is a very new kind of system, LiDAR, invisible lasers. As mentioned in the camera section, all of these use the same 3.5 millimeter stereo cord to connect between the camera and the sensor. Probably one of the biggest technical challenges for a custom camera trap is lighting. Most setups use a xenon flash like this, and these are very power hungry. They have a large capacitor in them, and they require a lot of battery power. So how do you keep something like this going for 1 week, 2 weeks, or even 4 weeks? It's a challenge. There are two basic flash systems that I use. This one involves a Vivitar 2800 flash unit, and this has been heavily modified and squeezed into this small food container. I found the plans to modify this flash on a website called Hag's House. These are actually fairly dangerous to work on. There's a large high voltage capacitor and it could kill you if you handle it wrong. So if you're not confident about doing something like that and aren't able to follow the instructions, don't do it. But I found these to be actually very good flash units. They're very lightweight and I can use a variety of different battery packs like D cell, C cell, and A cell. With A cells, I can get about 2 weeks of power. With D cells, about 6 weeks of power. One of the big problems with these flash units is they're actually fairly old and have a very high sync voltage. If you actually directly connect them up to your digital camera, you'll fry the camera. Don't do it. So if you want to be able to trigger this as a flash, you need to be able to make it into a slave flash. I actually incorporate a Wine Ultra Slave into this flash unit. Now these are expensive, but they're extremely reliable. So how do I make sure that these are safely triggered by my camera? I actually have to use a different kind of flash to pull that off. This is called a Wine Sync Link and is designed to trigger flash units that have slave sensors. Now when it comes out of the package, it actually has an infrared filter over this. You can't see the flash. I remove that filter, and when you do that, you actually find out it creates visible flash. Now what's cool about these is they'll run for about a month on two AA batteries. It's perfectly safe to hook up to your camera. I adapted an RCA cord for the purpose and it works great. When this flash is triggered, all the flashes with slave sensors are triggered at the exact same time. Once a photograph is taken, these flash units take about 6 seconds to recharge. I usually program my sensor to wait 6 seconds before it'll take another photograph, so these have time to power up. Another thing to remember about these, they have one power setting, one light output setting, that's it. Once these flash units are set up, they're very easy to deploy, they're very lightweight, and they fit in a backpack great. I've also used them for international travel, so they're very small and compact. For a more versatile light, a lot of people use Nikon flash units like this Nikon SP28, and I've built this into a special housing. These flash units have a lot more versatility. They have different power settings, they have a zoom head so you can adjust the light. You can capture rapid sequences. It has a very short recycle time, and you can capture 2, 3, even 4 frames per second. They also have a unique sleep feature which allows the flash unit to last for many weeks and not use up the battery. The problem with that is that you have to be able to wake up the flash unit to take a photograph. To solve this sleep problem, I need to have the camera communicate with the flash unit to wake it up before the first exposure. Now, I use a lot of Canon camera bodies and Nikon flash units, and they don't generally work together. Jeff Dale at TLRcam.com has solved this incompatibility problem. He has created a flash distribution system and will work with Nikon bodies, Canon bodies, and wake up Nikon flash units. And it uses this Cat5 cable, which is easily available at any electronics store. One of the drawbacks to a wired system is it can be a lot more cumbersome to set up, and it's a lot more of a large footprint for your camera system in the forest. What would be ideal is some kind of wireless system, and believe it or not, there's an option for that as well. There's a company out of Hong Kong called PixelPawn, and they actually make Nikon flash receivers and Canon transmitters. They also make Nikon transmitters. And what's cool about it is the Canon transmitter will wake up the Nikon flash. The only difficulty has been a lot of these have been bad out of the box. I've had a lot of problems having to send them back. They just don't work. When they work great. So if you buy these, make sure you test them before you put them out in the field. For most of my setups, I want the flexibility to use between 1 and 3 flash units. Now I think of it as kind of like setting up a studio in the woods and hoping that an animal will come by and take its photograph. That additional light allows me a great deal of creativity in how I'm going to light the scene. Even during daylight hours, that can make the difference between a good photograph and a bad one. Okay, the camera is set up. It's inside the cave. It'll be keeping a watchful eye on the entrance. Let's see what happens when we come back. There are about a million additional details about how to do camera trap setups that I haven't really been able to touch upon. But I hope this video gives you some idea about the challenges and the rewards of doing setups like this. Now, I've actually been thinking about doing a workshop, and I'm not sure how to do that. A lot of people who go to workshops expect to get results. They expect to get the photographs of whatever it is that workshop is about. But with camera traps, there are no guarantees. Many times you capture no images. Well, it's been 2 weeks since I put this camera in the cave, and I don't see a lot of evidence of any activity, but who knows? Well, let's go check it out. Let's see if we have any pictures on here. Well, there's the obligatory pictures of me, and I was right about the bushy-tailed wood rats, and it's raining, which is kind of neat. Wow, and now we have a mountain lion leaving the cave. There's no way this camera would have missed that mountain lion coming into the cave, so I can only guess. There's a little tiny hole at the back of the cave, something I could barely squeeze through, and I can only guess that mountain lion came in through that hole and then left through where the camera was pointing. It's kind of funny, her ears are turned back. These photos are interesting, but they're not really that great. It takes a lot of patience and persistence to get really good results with camera traps. I really love the challenge of doing this kind of work. And if you think it might be interesting to you and you might be interested in a workshop, go ahead and send me an email through my website. So until next time, I hope you found this entertaining and interesting.